care.
Good. Speak to the mariners. Fall to it, Jarly, or we run ourselves aground. Bestir! Bestir!
Cheerly! Cheerly, my heart! Yar! Yar! Take in the topsail! Take the master's whistle! Blow till thou burst thy wind, if room enough.
Good boatswain, have care!
Take in the topsail!
Where's the master? Play the men!
I pray now, keep below!
Where is the master, boatswain?
Lower!
Do you not hear him? You mar our labor! Keep to your cabins! You do assist the storm!
Nay, good, be patient!
When the sea is... Hence!
Hence!
What cares these roars for the name of the king? To cabin! Silence! Trouble us not!
Good, yet remember whom thou hast aboard.
None that I love more than myself. You are a counselor. If you can command these elements to silence, we will not hand a rope more. Cheerly, good hearts!
Yar!
Out of our way, I say! Down with the topmast!
Yar!
Lower! Lower! Bring her to dry with the main course! A plague upon this howling! They are louder than the weather or our office! What, lords? Still here? Shall we give o'er and drown? Have you a mind to sink?
A pox your throat, you bawling, blasphemous, and charitable dog!
Work you, then!
Hang, Krang! You whoreson, and insolent noisemaker! We are less afraid to be drowned than thou art!
A hold! A hold! Set her two courses! Off to sea again! Must our mouths be called?
The king and prince at prayers. Let's assist them, for our case is as theirs.
I am out of patience.
We are merely cheated of our lives by drunkards.
We split!
Farewell, my wife!
Let's all sink with the king.
Let's take leave of him.
Abandon ship!
Now would I give 1,000 furlongs of sea for an acre of barren ground, long heath, brown firs, anything. The wills above be done, but I would fain die a dry death.
The Stanford Shakespeare Company presents The Tempest by William Shakespeare.
By your art, my dearest parent, you have put the wild waters in this roar. Allay them! The sky, it seems, would pour down stinking pitch, but that the sea, mounting to the welkin's cheek, dashes the fire out. Oh, I have suffered with those that I saw suffer. A brave vessel, who had no doubt some noble creature in her, dashed all to pieces. Oh, the cry did knock against my very heart. Poor souls, they perished.
Be collected. No more amazement. Tell your piteous heart there's no harm done.
Oh, woe the day!
No harm. I have done nothing but in care of thee, my dear one, thee, my daughter, who art ignorant of what thou art, not knowing from whence I am, nor that I am more better than Prospero, master of a full poor cell, and thy no greater guardian.
More to know did never meddle with my thoughts.
'Tis time I should inform thee further. Lend thy hand and pluck my magic garment from me. So lie there, my art. Wipe thou thine eyes. Have comfort. The direful spectacle of the rack, which touched the very virtue of compassion in thee, I have with such provision in mine art, so safely ordered that there is no soul, no, not so much perdition as an hair, betid to any creature in the vessel which thou heardst cry, which thou sawst sink. Sit down, for thou must now know further. Uh-huh. Obey and be attentive. Canst thou remember a time before we came unto this cell? I do not think thou canst, for then thou wast not out 3 years old.
Certainly I can. 'Tis far off, and rather like a dream. Had I not 4 or 5 women once that tended me?
Thou hadst, and more, Miranda, but how is it that this lives in thy mind? What seest thou else in the dark backward and abysm of time?
Nothing.
12 years since, Miranda. 12 years since thy parent was the Duke of Milan, and a renowned royal, and my only heir, a princess, no worse issued.
Oh, the heavens! What foul play had we that we came from thence, or blessed was it we did?
Both, my girl, by foul play, as thou sayest, were we heaved thence, but blessedly hope hither.
Oh, my heart bleeds to think of the teen that I have turned you to, which is from my remembrance. Please you farther.
My sister and thy strange aunt called Antonia, I pray thee, mark me, that a sister should be so perfidious, she whom next thyself of all the world I loved, and to her put the manage of my state, as at that time the liberal arts were all my study, thus the government I cast upon my sister, and to my state grew stranger, being transported and wrapped in secret studies. Thy false aunt, dost thou attend me?
Yes, most heedfully.
Thy false aunt, having both the key of officer and office, set all hearts in the state to what tune pleased her ear. That now she was the ivy which had hid my princely trunk and sucked my verdure out on it. Thou attend'st not.
Oh, I do.
I pray thee, mark me, I, thus neglecting all worldly ends, all dedicated to closeness and the bettering of my mind, in my false sister awaked an evil nature. She did believe she was indeed the Duke. Me, poor me, my library was dukedom large enough. Dost thou hear?
Your tale would cure deafness.
The King of Naples, being an enemy to me inveterate, hearkens my sister's suit, which was that he should presently extirpate me and mine out of the dukedom, and confer fair Milan with all the honors on my sister, whereon a treacherous army levied. One midnight, fated to the purpose, did Antonia open the gates of Milan, and in the dead of darkness, the ministers for the purpose hurried thence me and thy crying self.
Alack, for pity! I, not remembering how I cried out, then will cry it out or again. It is a hint that rings my eyes to it.
Aboard a bark they bore us some leagues to sea, where they prepared a rotten carcass of a butt, not rigged nor tackle, sail nor mast. The very rats instinctively have quit it. There they hoist us to cry to the sea that roared to us, to sigh to the winds whose pity, sighing back again, did us but loving wrong.
Alack, what trouble was I then to you?
A cherubin thou wast, that did preserve me. Thou didst smile infused with a fortitude from heaven, when I have decked the sea with drops full salt under my burden groaned, which raised in me an undergoing stomach to bear up against what should ensue.
How came we ashore?
By providence divine. Some food we had and some fresh water, that a noble Neapolitan, Gonzalo, out of his charity did give us, with rich garments, linens, stuffs, and necessaries, which since have steaded much. So of his gentleness, knowing I loved my books, he furnished me from mine own library with volumes that I prize above my dukedom. And here in this island we arrived.
Would I might but ever see that man. And now I pray you for stilled his beating in my mind. Your reason for raising this sea storm?
No thus far forth. By accident most strange, bountiful fortune, now my dear lady, hath mine enemies brought to this shore. Here cease more questions. Thou art inclined to sleep. 'Tis a good dullness, and give it way. I know thou canst not choose. Come away, servant, come. I am ready now. Approach, my Ariel, come.
All hail, great master! Grave sir, hail!
I come to answer thy best pleasure. Be it to fly, to swim, to dive into the fire, to ride on the curled clouds, to thy strong bidding task,
Ariel and all her quality.
Hast thou spirit? Performed to point the tempest that I bade thee.
To every article. I boarded the king's ship, now on the beak, now in the waist, the deck, in every cabin. I flamed amazement!
Sometimes I divide and burn in many places, on the topmast, the yards, and bowsprit, when I flame distinctly, then meet and join again. Jove's lightning, the precursors of the dreadful thunderclaps, the fire and cracks of sulphurous roaring, the most mighty Neptune seems to besiege, and make his bold waves tremble, yea, his dread trident shake.
My brave spirits! Who was so firm, so constant, that this coil would not infect his reason?
Not a soul, but felt the fever of the mad, and played some tricks of desperation. All but mariners plunged in the foaming brine and quit the vessel, then all afire with me. The king's son, Ferdinand, with hair upstaring, then like weeds, not hair, was the first man that leapt, cried,
"Hell is empty, and all the devils are here!"
Why, that's my spirit. But are they, Ariel, safe?
Not a hair perished. On their sustaining garments, not a blemish, but fresher than before. And, as thou bad'st me, in troops I have dispersed them bout the isle.
Of the king's ship, the mariners, say how thou hast disposed, and all the rest of the fleet.
Safely in harbor is the king's ship, in a deep nook, where once thou call'st me up at midnight to fetch dew. The mariners all under hatches stowed, who, with a charm joined in their suffered labor, I have left asleep.
Ariel, thy charge exactly is performed. But there's more work.
Is there more toil? Since thou dost give me pains, let me remember thee what thou hast promised, which is not yet performed to me.
How now? Moody? What is it thou canst demand?
My liberty.
Before the time be out, no more.
I prithee, remember I have done thee worthy service, told thee no lies, made no mistakings, served without or grudge or grumblings. Thou did promise to bait me a full year.
Dost thou forget from what a torment I did free thee?
No.
Thou liest, malignant thing. Hast thou forgot the foul witch Sycorax, who with age and envy was grown into a hoop? Hast thou forgot her?
No, sir.
Thou hast. I must once in a month recount what thou hast been which thou forgetst. This damned witch Sycorax, for mischiefs manifold, and sorceries terrible to enter human hearing, thou knowest, was banished. Or is not this true?
Aye, sir.
This blue-eyed hag was hither brought with child, and here was left by the sailors. Thou, my slave, as thou reportest thyself, was then her servant. And for thou wast a spirit too delicate to act her earthy and abhorred commands, refusing her grand hests, she did confine thee, and in her most unmitigable rage into a cloven pine, within which rift, imprisoned, thou didst painfully remain a dozen years, within which space she died and left thee there, where thou didst vent thy groans as fast as mill wheels strike. Then was this island, save for the son that she did litter here, a freckled whelp, hag-born, not honored with a human shape.
Yes, Caliban, her son.
Dull thing, I say so, that Caliban, whom now I keep in service. Thou best knowest the torment I did find thee in. Thy groans did make wolves howl, and penetrate the breasts of ever angry bears. It was a torment to lay upon the damned, which Sycorax could not again undo. It was mine art, when I arrived and heard thee, that made gape the pine and let thee out.
I thank thee, master.
If thou more murmurest, I will rend an oak and peg thee in his knotty entrails till thou hast howled away 12 winters.
Pardon, master. I will be correspondent to command and do my spriting gently.
Do so. And after 2 days, I will discharge thee.
That's my noble master. What shall I do? Say, what? What shall I do?
Where hast thou placed the young prince, Ferdinand?
The king's son have I landed by himself, whom I left cooling of the air with sighs in an odd angle of the isle, and sitting, his arms in a sad knot.
Go, make thyself like a nymph of the sea. Be subject to no sight but thine and mine, invisible to every eyeball else. Go, take this shape, and bring hither the prince. Go, hence, with diligence.
My lord, it shall be done.
Awake, dear heart, awake. Thou hast slept well. Awake, my sweet Miranda.
The strangeness of your story put heaviness in me.
Shake it off. Come on, we'll visit Caliban, my slave who never yields us kind answer.
'Tis a villain I do not love to look on.
But as it is, we cannot miss him. He does make our fire, fetch in our wood, and serves in offices that profit us. What ho, slave Caliban? Thou earth, thou speak.
There's wood enough within.
Thou poisonous thing, got by the devil himself upon thy wicked dam. Come forth.
As wicked dew is ere my mother brushed with raven's feather from unwholesome fen, drop on you both. A southwest wind blow and blister you all o'er.
For this, be sure. Tonight thou shalt have cramps, side stitches that shall pen thy breath up. Thou shalt be pinched as thick as honeycomb, each pinch more stinging than bees that made them.
I must eat my dinner. This island's mine. By Sycorax, my mother, which thou takest from me. When thou camest first, thou strokest me and made much of me. Give me water with berries in it. And teach me how to name the bigger light and how the less that burn by day and night. And then I loved thee. Showed thee all the qualities of the isle, the fresh springs, brine pits, barren place, and fertile. Cursed be that I did so. All the charms of Sycorax, toads, beetles, bats, light on you, for I am all the subjects that you have, which first was mine own king, and stymie in this hard rock, whiles you do keep for me the rest of the island.
Thou most lying wretch! Whom stripes may move, not kindness, I have used thee, filth as thou art, with humane care, and lodge thee in mine own cell, till thou did seek to violate the honor of my child.
Would it had been done! Thou didst prevent me. I had peopled else this isle with Calibans.
Abhorred fiend! Which any print of goodness wilt not take, being capable of all ill, I pitied thee, took pains to make thee speak, taught thee each hour one thing or other. When thou didst not, devil, know thine own meaning, but wouldst gabble like a thing most brutish, I endowed thy purposes with words that made them known. But thy vile blood, though thou didst learn, had that in it which good natures could not abide to be with. Thou deservedly confined into this rock who hadst deserved more than a prison.
You taught me language. My profit on it is I know how to curse.
Hagseed, hence. Fetch us in fuel and be quick. Thou art best to answer other business. Shruggest thou? Malice? If thou neglect or dost unwillingly what I command, I'll rack thee with old cramps, fill all thy bones with aches, make thee roar that beasts shall tremble at thy din.
No, pray thee.
So, slave, hence.
Unto these yellow sands, and then take hands, and then take hands, curtsy when you have and kissed the wild waves whilst
upon some god of the island, sitting on a bank, weeping again, the king my father's rack. This music crept by me upon the waters, allaying both their fury and my passion with its sweet air. Thence I have followed it, or it hath drawn me, rather. But 'tis gone. No, it begins again.
Father, fly, father lies. Love is born, your coral maid. Those are pearls that were his eyes. Nothing of him. Yeah.
does remember my drowned father. This is no mortal business, nor no sound that the earth owes. I hear it now above me.
Miranda, the fringed curtains of thine eye advance and say what thou seest yond.
What is it? A spirit? Lord, how it looks about! Believe me, it carries a brave form. But 'tis a spirit.
No, girl, it eats and sleeps and hath such senses as we have, such. This gallant, which thou seest, was in the rack, and, but he's something stained with grief. That's beauty's canker. Thou mightst call him a goodly person. He hath lost his fellows and strays about to find them.
I might call him a thing divine, for nothing natural I ever saw so noble.
It goes on, I see, as my soul prompts it. Ariel, fine Ariel, I'll free thee within 2 days for this.
Most sure the goddess on whom these heirs attend. Oh, you wonder. Be you a goddess or a maid?
No wonder, sir, but certainly a maid.
My language! Heavens! I am the best of them that speak this speech, were I but where 'tis spoken.
How? The best? What wert thou if the King of Naples heard thee?
Myself am Naples, who with mine eyes, never since at ebb, beheld the king my father racked. I am Prince Ferdinand.
Alack for mercy!
At the first sight they have changed eyes. Delicate Ariel, I'll set thee free for this. A word, good sir? I fear you have done yourself some wrong. A word?
Why speaks my guardian so ungently? This is the second man that I e'er saw, the first that I e'er sighed for. Pity move my parent to be inclined my way.
If your affection not gone forth, I'll make you the Queen of Naples.
They are both in either's powers. One word more, I charge thee that thou attend me. Thou dost here usurp the name thou owest not, and hast put thyself upon this island as a spy.
I don't think
no,
so.
To win it from me, the lord on it.
No, as I am a man.
There's nothing ill can dwell in such a temple.
Speak not you for him, he's a traitor. Follow me, false prince, come. I'll manacle thy neck and feet together.
No.
Seawater shalt thou drink. Thy food shall be the fresh brook mussels, withered roots and husks wherein the acorn cradled. Follow.
No, I will resist such entertainment till mine enemy has more power.
Oh, my. Oh, dear protector, make not too rash a trial of him, for he's gentle and not fearful.
What? I say, my foot, my tutor? Put thy sword up, traitor, who makest a show but dare not strike. Thy conscience is so possessed with guilt. Come from thy ward, for I can here disarm thee with this stick and make thy weapon drop.
Beseech you, my guardian!
Hence, hang not on my garments!
Have pity, I'll be his surety!
Silence! One word more shall make me chide thee, if not hate thee. What? An advocate for an impostor. Hush. Thou think'st there are no more such shapes as he, having seen but him and Caliban. Foolish wench. To the most of men, this is a Caliban. Nay, to him are angels.
My affections are then most humble. I have no ambition to see a goodlier man.
Ugh. Come, man, obey. Thy nerves are in their infancy again, and have no vigor in them.
So they are. My spirits, as in a dream, are all bound up. My father's loss, the weakness which I feel, the rack of all my friends, nor your rough threats to which I am subdued, are but light to me. Might I but through my prison once a day behold this maid. All else corners of the earth let liberty make use of. Space enough have I in such a prison.
Be of comfort, kind prince. My parents of a better nature, sir, than they appear by speech. This is unwanted, which now came from them.
Come follow, young man. Miranda, speak not for him. It works. Come on, fine Ariel. Thou hast done well and shalt be as free as mountain winds. But then, exactly do all points of my command.
To the syllable.
Beseech your grace, be merry. You have cause, so have we all, of joy, for our escape is much beyond our loss. Our hint of woe is common. Every day some sailor's wife, the masters of some merchant, and the merchant have just our theme of woe. But for the miracle, I mean our preservation, few in millions can speak like us. And wisely, good sir, weigh our sorrow with our comfort.
Prithee, peace.
The king receives comfort like cold porridge.
Therefore, my king...
Fie, what a spendthrift is Gonzalo of his tongue.
I prithee, spare me, Gonzalo.
Well, I have done, but yet...
Oh, Antonia, he will be talking.
The isle's air breathes upon us most sweetly.
As if he had lungs and rotten ones.
Or as 'twere perfumed by a swamp.
Here is everything advantageous to life.
True. Save means to live.
Of that, there's none or little.
But the rarity of it is, which is indeed almost beyond credit.
As many vouched rarities are.
That our garments, being as they were, drenched in the sea, hold, notwithstanding their freshness and gloss. Being rather new dyed than stained with salt water. Methinks our garments are now as fresh as when we first put them on. Is it not, my king, this doublet, as fresh as the first day I wore it? I mean, in a sort.
That sort was well fished for.
When I wore it, my king, at your daughter's marriage.
You cram these words into mine ears against the stomach of my sense. Would I had never married my daughter there, for coming thence my Ferdinand is lost! Oh, thou mine heir of Naples and of Milan, what strange fish hath made his meal on thee?
Sir, he is dead. We have lost your son. I fear forever. The fault's your own.
My lord Sebastian, the truth you speak doth lack some gentleness and time to speak it in. You rub the sore when you should bring the plaster.
Very well.
It is foul weather in us all, my king, when you are cloudy. Had I a plantation of this isle, my king...
He'd sow it with nettle seed.
And were the king on it, what would I do?
Scape being drunk for want of wine.
In the Commonwealth, no kind of traffic would I admit. No name of magistrate, letters should not be known. Riches, poverty, use of service, none, contract, succession, born, bound of land, tilts, vineyard, none, no sovereignty.
Yet he would be king on it.
The latter end of his commonwealth forgets the beginning.
I would, with such perfections, govern, sir, it would excel the golden age.
Oh, save his majesty.
Long live Gonzalo.
And do you mark me, my king?
Prithee, no more. Thou dost talk nothing to me.
I do well believe, your highness, these gentlewomen are of such sensible and nimble lungs that they always used to laugh at nothing.
'Twas you we laughed at.
Who in this kind of merry fooling am nothing to you, so you may continue and laugh at nothing still.
Oh, what a blow was there given.
If it had not fallen flat.
Oh, nay, good Gonzalo, be not angry.
No, I warned you. I will not adventure my discretion so weakly. Will you laugh me asleep? For I am very heavy.
Go sleep and hear us.
What? Gonzalo asleep? I wish mine eyes would, with themselves, shut up my thoughts. I find they're inclined to do so.
Please, you sir. Do not omit the heavy offer of it. It seldom visits sorrow. When it doth, it is a comforter.
We too, my king, will guard your person while you take your rest and watch your safety.
Thank you. Wondrous heavy.
What a strange drowsiness possesses them.
It is the quality of the climate.
Why doth it not, then, our eyelids sink? I find not myself disposed to sleep, Antonia.
Nor I, Sebastian. My spirits are nimble. They fell together both as by consent. They dropped as by a thunderstroke. What might, worthy Sebastian? Oh, what might? No more. And yet, methinks I see it in thy face what thou shouldst be. The occasion speaks thee, and my strong imagination sees a crown dropping upon thy head.
What? Are thou waking?
Do you not hear me speak?
I do, and surely it is a sleepy language, and thou speaks out of thy sleep. What is it thou didst say?
Noble Sebastian, thou lettest thy fortune sleep, die rather, winkst while thou art waking.
Thou dost snore distinctly. There's meaning in thy snores.
I am more serious than my custom. You must be so too, if heed me.
Well, I am standing water.
I'll teach you how to flow.
Say on.
Will you grant with me that Ferdinand is drowned?
He's gone.
Then tell me, who's the next heir of Naples?
Alonso's daughter, Claribel.
She that is queen of Tunis. She that dwells 10 leagues beyond man's life. She that from Naples can have no note. She that from whom we all were sea-swallowed, though some cast again, and by that destiny to perform an act whereof what's past is prologue. What's to come in yours and my discharge?
What stuff is this? How, say you?
Say this were death that now hath seized them. Why, they are no worse than now they are. There be that can rule Naples as well as he that sleeps. Lords that can prate as amply and unnecessarily as this Gonzalo. Oh, that you bore the mind that I do. What a sleep were this for your advancement. Do you understand me?
Methinks I do. I remember you did supplant your sibling Prospero.
True. And look how well my garments sit upon me, much feeter than before. Prospero's servants were then my fellows. Now they are my men.
But for your conscience?
Aye, Sebastian, where lies that? Here lies your brother, the king himself, no better than the earth he lies upon. If he were that which now he's like, that's dead, whom I with this obedient steel, 3 inches of it, can lay to bed forever. Whiles you, doing thus, to the perpetual wink for eye might put this ancient morsel, this Gonzalo, who should not upbraid our course. For all the rest, they'll take suggestion as a cat laps milk.
Thy case, dear friend, shall be my precedent. As thou got Milan, I'll come by Naples. Draw thy sword. 1 stroke shall free thee from the tribute which thou payst. And I, the king, shall love thee.
Draw together, and when I rear my hand, do you the like to follow.
Not unconcerned.
Master, through their art, foresees the danger that you, their friend, are in, and sends me forth. For else, Prospero's scheme untimely dies to keep the king and Gonzalo alive.
why are you destroying life? Open-eyed conspiracy is time doth take. If of life you keep a care, shake off slumber and beware.
Now, good angels, preserve the king.
Why? How now? Oh, awake? Why are your swords drawn? Wherefore this ghastly looking, Antonia?
Lord Sebastian, what's the matter?
Whilst we stood here securing your repose, even now we heard a hollow burst of bellowing like bulls or rather lions. Did it not wake you? It struck mine ear most terribly.
I heard nothing.
Oh, 'twas a din to fright a monster's ear, to make an earthquake. Sure, it was the roar of a whole herd of lions.
Heard you this, Gonzalo?
Upon mine honor, sir, I heard a humming, and that a strange one too, which did awake me. As mine eyes opened, I saw their weapons drawn. There was a noise, that's verily. 'Tis best we stand upon our guard, or that we quit this place. Let's draw our weapons.
Lead off this ground, and let's make further search for my poor son, Ferdinand.
Heavens, keep him from these beasts, for he is sure on the island.
Lead away.
Prospero, my lord, shall know what I have done. So, king, go safely on to seek thy son.
All the infections that the sun sucks up from bogs, fens, flats, on Prospero fall and make them by inch meal a disease. Their spirits hear me. And yet, I needs must curse, but for every trifle are they set upon me. Sometimes like apes that mow and chatter at me and after bite me, then like hedgehogs which lie tumbling in my bare foot way and mount their pricks at my footfall. Sometime I am all wound with adders who with cloven tongues do hiss me into madness. Lo, now, lo, here comes a spirit of old Prospero to torment me for bringing wooden slow. Thus I'll fall flat and hide under my cloak. Perchance you will not mind me.
Here's neither bush nor shrub to bear off any weather at all.
And another storm brewing. I hear it sing in the wind. If it should thunder as it did before, I know not where to hide my head. What have we here? A man? Or a fish? Dead or alive?
Oh, fish! He smells like a fish! Very ancient and fish-like smell. Strange fish. Legged like a man, and his fins like arms?
Warm, Omatroth! Oh! I do now let loose my opinion, hold it no longer. This is no fish, but an islander that hath lately suffered by a thunderbolt. Ah! Alas! The storm has come again. My best way is to creep under his cloak. There's no other shelter hereabout. Misery acquaints a man with strange bedfellows.
I will here shroud beneath this cloak till the dredge of the storm be past.
I shall go war to sea, to sea. Here shall I tie ashore.
This is a very scurvy tune to sing at a man's funeral. Well, here's my comfort. Mm. Me. The master, the swabber, the bosun and I, the gunner and his mate. Love Mal, Megan, Marion, and Marjorie, but none of us cared for Kate. For she had a tongue with a tang, would cry to a sailor, go hang, go hang. She loved not the savor of tar nor of pitch, yet a tailor might scratch her whereas she did itch. Then to sea, boys, and let her go hang.
Do not torment me. Oh.
What's the matter? Have we devils here? I have not escaped drowning to be afeared now of your four legs.
The spirit torments me.
This is some monster of the isle with four legs who hath got, as I take it, a fever. Where the devil should he learn our language? I will give him some relief if it be but for that. If I can recover him and keep him tame and get to Naples with him, he's a present for any emperor that trod on neat's leather.
Do not torment me, prithee. I'll bring my wood home faster.
He's in his fit now and does not talk after the wisest. He shall taste of my bottle. If he have never drunk wine afore, it will go near to remove his fit.
Thou dost me yet but little hurt. Thou wilt anon. I know it by thy trembling. Now Prospero works upon thee.
Come on your ways. Open your mouth. Here is that which will give language to you, cat. Open your mouth. This will shake your shaking, I can tell you, and that soundly. Oh, you cannot tell who's your friend. Open your chaps again.
I should know that voice. It should be. But he is drowned. And these are devils. Oh!
Four legs and two voices. A most delicate monster. His forward voice now is to speak well of his friend. His backward voice is to utter foul speeches and to detract. If all the wine in my body will recover him, I will help his fever. Come! Amen! I will pour some in thy other mouth.
Stefano!
Doth thy other mouth call me? Mercy, mercy, this is a devil and no monster. I will leave him.
Stefano, if thou be Stefano, touch me and speak to me, for I am Trinculo. Be not afeard, thy good friend Trinculo.
If thou beest Trinculo, come forth. I'll pull thee by the lesser legs. If any be Trinculo's legs, these are they. Oh, thou art very Trinculo indeed. How camest thou to be the siege of this monster? Can he, excrete Trinculos?
I took him to be killed with a thunderstroke. But art thou not drowned, Stefano? I hope now thou art not drowned.
Trinculo, how didst thou escape? How camest thou hither? Swear by this bottle how thou camest hither.
These be fine things, and if they not be sprites, that's a brave god and bears celestial liquor. I will kneel to him.
Swear then.
I'll swear upon that bottle to be thy true subject. For the liquor is not earthly.
Here then, Trinculo, swear then how thou escaped.
Swim ashore, man, like a duck. I can swim like a duck, I'll be sworn.
Here, kiss the book. Though thou canst swim like a duck, thou art made like a goose.
Oh, Stefano, hast any more of this?
The whole buck, man. My cellar is in a rock by the seaside, where my wine is hid. How now, Mooncalf? How does thine fever?
Hast thou not dropped from heaven?
Come, swear to that. Kiss the book. I will furnish it anon with new contents. Swear.
Yeah.
By this good light, this is a very shallow monster. I afeard of him? A very weak monster. A most poor, credulous monster. Well drawn, monster, in good sooth.
I'll show thee every fertile inch of the island, and I will kiss thy foot. I prithee, be my god.
By this light, a most perfidious and drunken monster. When his god's asleep, he'll rob his bottle.
I'll kiss thy foot. I'll swear myself thy subject.
Come on, then. Down and swear.
I shall laugh myself to death at this puppy-headed monster. A most scurvy monster. I could find it in my heart to beat him, but that the poor monster didn't drink. An abominable monster.
I'll show thee the best springs. I'll pluck the berries. I'll fish for thee and get the wood enough. A plague upon the tyrant that I serve. I'll bear them no more sticks, but follow thee, thou wondrous man, Lord Stefano.
Most ridiculous monster! To make a wonder of a poor drunkard.
I prithee, let me bring thee where crabs grow, and I, with my long nails, will dig thee pig nuts, show thee a jay's nest, and instruct thee how to snare the nimble marmoset. I'll bring thee clustering filberts, and sometimes I'll get thee young scambles from the rock. Wilt thou go with me?
I prithee now. Lead the way without any more talking. Trinculum, the king and all our company else being drowned, we will inherit.
Here.
Here, bear my bottle. Fellow Trinculo, we'll fill him by and by again.
farewell, master, farewell, farewell. No more dams I'll make for fish.
A howling monster. A drunken monster.
The accordion.
Nor fetch and firing at requiring, nor scrape trencher ring, nor wash dish. And Van Cacaliban has a new master, get a new man. Freedom!
Hiding!
Hiding!
Freedom! Freedom! Hiding!
Freedom! Oh, brave monster! Lead the way!
Farewell, master, farewell, farewell. No more dams I'll make for fish. Nor fish and firing at requiring. Swig and drink nor wash dish.
Ban, ban, Cacaliban
has a new master, get a new man. Freedom,
hiday, hiday. Freedom, freedom, hiday.
God, he says.
Freedom!
The Tempest will now take a 10-minute intermission. Refreshments can be found in your kitchen. If you bought some recently. I don't know where the bathroom is, but you probably know. The Tempest will return in 2 minutes. The Tempest will begin shortly.
There be some sports are painful, and their labor delight in them sets off. Some kinds of baseness are nobly undergone, and most poor matters point to rich ends. This my mean task would be as heavy to me as odious. But the mistress which I serve quickens what's dead and makes my labors pleasures. Oh, she's 10 times more gentle than her parents. Crabbed, and they're composed of harshness. I must remove some thousands of these logs and pile them up upon a sore injunction. My sweet mistress weeps when she sees me work, and says such baseness had never like executor. I forget, but these sweet thoughts do even refresh my labors most busiest when I do it.
Oh. Ferdinand, I see, still labors there. But soft, here comes my sweet Miranda presently. I'll hide me in the arbor.
Alas, now pray you, work not so hard. I would the lightning had burnt up those logs that you are enjoined to pile.
Oh, most dear mistress, the sun will set before I shall discharge what I must strive to do.
If you'll sit down, I'll bear your logs the while. Pray, give me that. I'll carry it to the pile.
No, precious creature. I'd rather crack my sinews, break my back, than you should such dishonor undergo while I sit lazy by.
It would become me as well as it does you. And I should do it with much more ease, for my goodwill is to it, and yours it is against. You look wearily.
No! Noble mistress, 'tis fresh morning with me when you are by at night. I do beseech you, chiefly that I might set it in my prayers. What is your name?
Miranda. Oh, my guardian, I have broke your hest to say so.
Admired Miranda. Indeed, the top of admiration, worth what's dearest to the world, and you, oh, you, so perfect and so peerless, are created of every creature's best.
How features are abroad, I am skillless of. but I would not wish any companion in the world but you. Nor can imagination form a shape besides yourself to like of. But I prattle something too wildly, and my parents' precepts I therein do forget.
I am in my condition a prince, Miranda. I do think a king. I would not so. Hear my soul speak. The very instant that I saw you did my heart fly to your service. There resides to make me slave to it. And for your sake am I this patient logman.
Do you love me?
Oh, heaven. Oh, earth. Bear witness to this sound and crown what I profess with kind event if I speak true, if hollowly invert what best is boded me to mischief. I, beyond all limit of what else in the world, do love, prize, honor you.
I am a fool to weep at what I am glad of.
Wherefore weep you?
At mine unworthiness, that dare not offer what I desire to give, and much less take what I shall die to want. But this is trifling, and all the more it seeks to hide itself, the bigger bulk it shows. Hence, bashful cunning, and prompt me plain and holy innocence. I am your wife if you will marry me. If not, I'll die your maid. To be your fellow you may deny me, but I'll be your servant whether you will or no.
My mistress, dearest, and I thus humble ever.
My husband, then.
I, with a heart as willing as bondage, heir of freedom, here's my hand.
And mine, with my heart in it. And now farewell till half an hour hence.
A thousand thousand.
Fair encounter of two most rare affections. So glad of this as they, I cannot be, who are surprised withal, but my rejoicing at nothing can be more. I'll to my book, for yet ere supper time must I perform much business appertaining.
Trigulo, tell not me. When the bud is out, we will drink water, not a drop before. Therefore, bear up and boredom. Servant monster, drink to me.
Servant monster? The folly of this island. Mm-hmm. They say there's but five upon this isle. We're three of them. If the other two be brain like us, the state totters.
Drink, servant monster, when I bid thee. Thy eyes are almost set in thy head.
Where should they be set else? He were a strange monster indeed if they were set in his tail.
My man monster hath drowned his tongue in sack. Thou shalt be my lieutenant monster, or my standard. Mooncalf, speak once in thy life if thou beest a good mooncalf.
How does thy honor? Let me lick thy shoe. I'll not serve Trinculo, he's not valiant.
Thou liest, most ignorant monster!
Here we go.
I am in case to justice constable! One, thou debauched fish, thou! Was there ever man a coward that drank so much sack as I did? Wilt thou tell a monstrous lie, being but half a fish and half a monster?
Lo, how he mocks me. Wilt thou let him, Lord Stefano?
Lord, quoth he, that a monster should be such a natural.
Lo again. Bite him to death, I prithee.
Trinculo, keep a good tongue in your head. If you prove a mutineer, the next treat. The poor monster's my subject, and he shall not suffer indignity.
I thank my noble lord. Wilt thou be pleased to hearken once again to the suit I made to thee?
Marry, will I? Kneel and repeat it. I will stand. And so shall Trinculo.
As I told thee before, I am subject to a tyrant. the sorcerer Prospero that by their cunning hath cheated me of this island.
Thou liest!
Thou jesting monkey! Ooh. Thou Dracula! I would my valiant master would destroy thee. I do not lie.
Dracula, if you trouble him any more in this tale, by this hands, I will supplant some of your teeth.
Why? I said nothing!
Come then, and no more. Proceed, monster.
I say by sorcery Prospero got this isle from me. They got it. If thy greatness will, revenge it on them, for I know thou darest, but this thing Tranquilo dare not.
That's most certain.
What did I do to you?
Thou shalt be lord of the island, and I'll serve thee.
How now shall this be compassed? Canst thou bring me to the party?
Yeah, my lord, I'll yield prosperous sleep, where thou mayst knock a nail into their head.
Thou liest, thou canst not.
What a pie nit is this, thou scurvy patch?
Dracula!
I do beseech thy greatness. Give him blows and take his bottle from him.
Run into no further danger.
No.
Interrupt the monster one word further, and by this hand I'll turn my mercy out of the doors and make a stockfish of thee.
Why? What did I? I did nothing. I'll go farther off.
Didst thou not say he lied?
Thou liest.
Do I so? Take thou that. If you like that, Trinculo, give me the lie another time.
I did not give the lie out of your wits and hearing, too. Oh, a pox on your bottle. This can sack and drinking do. A moraine on your monster, and the devil take your finger.
Now forward with your tale. Come, proceed.
Why, as I told thee, 'tis a custom with them in the afternoon to sleep. Mm-hmm. There thou mayst brain them, having first seized their books, or with a log batter their skull, or punch them with a stake, or cut their weasand with thy knife. Remember first to possess their books, for without them they're but a sot. As I am, nor hath one spirit to command, burn but their books. And that most deeply to consider is the beauty of their daughter.
Monster, I will kill this Prospero. Miranda and I will be king and queen, save our graces, and Trinculo and thyself shall be viceroys. Dost thou like the plot, Trinculo?
Excellent.
Give me thy hand. I am sorry I beat thee, but while thou livest, keep a good tongue in thy head.
Within this hour will Prosper be asleep. Wilt thou destroy them then?
Aye, on mine honor.
This will I tell my master.
Thou makest me merry. I am full of pleasure. Let us be jocund. Wilt thou troll the catch you taught me but while ere?
Ha! At thy request, monster, I will do reason any reason. Come on, Trinculo, let us sing. Flout'em and count'em and scout'em and flout'em. Thought is free.
That's not the tune.
What is this same?
This is the tune of our catch. Played by the picture of nobody.
If thou beest a man, show thyself in thy likeness. If thou beest the devil, take it as thou list.
Oh, forgive me my sin.
He that dies pays all debts. I defy thee. Mercy upon us.
Art thou afeard?
No, monster. Not I.
Be not afeard. The isle is full of noises, sounds, and sweet airs that give delight and hurt not. Sometimes a thousand twangling instruments will hum about mine ears, and sometimes voices
that if I had waked after a long sleep will make me sleep again. And then in dreaming, the clouds, methought, would open and show riches ready to drop upon me. That when I waked, I cried to dream again.
Prove a brave kingdom to me.
When Prospero is destroyed.
That shall be by and by. I remember the story.
The sound is going away. Let's follow it and after do our work.
Lead, monster. We'll follow. I would I could see this tabor. He lays it on. Wilt come?
I'll follow, Stefano. Mm.
By Laken, I can go no more, my king. My old bones ache. By your patience, I needs must rest me.
Old Gonzalo, I cannot blame thee, who am myself attached with weariness to the dulling of my spirits. Sit down and rest. Even here, I will put off my hope, and keep it no longer for my flatterer. He is drowned, whom thus we stray to find, and the sea mocks our frustrate search on land. Well, let him go.
Good Sebastian, I am right glad that he's so out of hope. Do not, for one repulse, forgo the purpose that you resolved to effect.
The next advantage we will take thoroughly, Antonia.
Let it be tonight, for now they are oppressed with travel. They will not, nor cannot, use such vigilance as when they were fresh.
I say tonight, no more. What?
You are three lords of sin, whom destiny, the never-sharpening sea, have caused to belch up you. And on this island, you most men being most unfit to live. I have made you mad, and even with such like valor, mortals hang and drown their themselves. You fools! I and my fellows are ministers of fate. The elements of whom your swords are tempered may as well wound the loud winds or kill the still closing waters. Supplant good Prospero, exposed unto the sea, them and their innocent child, for which foul deeds the power still delaying, not forgetting, having sensed the seas and shores, yea, all the creatures against your peace. Be of thy son, Alonso, they have left, and do pronounce by me lingering perdition, worse than any death can be at once. Nothing but heart's sorrow, and a clear life ensuing.
Name something holy, my king. Why stand you in this strange stare?
Oh, it is monstrous! Monstrous! Methought the billow spoke and told me of it. The winds did sing it to me, and the thunder, that deep and dreadful organ pipe, pronounced the name of Prospero.
it did base my trespass. Therefore, my son, in the ooze is bedded, and I'll seek him deeper than air plummet sounded, and with him there lie mudded.
But one fiend at a time, I'll fight their legions o'er.
I'll be thy second.
All three of them are desperate. Their great guilt, like poison, given to work a great time after, now begins to bite the spirits.
Austerely punish you, your compensation makes amends, for I have, Ferdinand, given you mine own life, or that for which I live, who once again I tender to thy hand. All thy vexations were but my trials of thy love, and thou hast strangely stood the test. Here afore heaven I ratify this, my rich gift. Ferdinand, do not smile at me that I boast of her. For thou shalt find she will outstrip all praise and make it halt behind her.
I do believe it, against an oracle.
Then, as my gift and thine own acquisition worthily purchased, take my daughter. Sit then and talk with her. Miranda is thine own. What's Ariel? My industrious servants, Ariel.
What would my potent master? Here I am.
Bravely the figure of this harpy hast thou performed, my Ariel. A grace it had, devouring. And these mine enemies are all knit up in their distractions. They are now in my power. And in these fits, I leave them. But enough. Go bring the rabble here to this place. Incite them to quick motion, for I must bestow upon the eyes of this young couple some vanity of mine art. It is my promise, and they expect it from me.
Presently?
Aye, with a twink.
Before you can say come and go, and breathing twice and cry so-so, each one tripping on his toe will be here with mop and mow. Do you love me, master? No?
Dearly, my delicate Ariel, be our ghostly players ready.
Aye, my lord. They stay upon your patience.
Go, bring them in, and take your place, my sprite. No tongue, all eyes. Be silent. Most bounteous lady, thy rich lees, wheat, rye, barley, vetches, oats, and peas, thy turfy mountains where live nibbling sheep, and flat meads thatched with stover them to keep, thy banks with pionid and twillet brims, which spongy April at thy hest betrims to make cold nymphs' chaste crowns, and thy broom groves whose shadow the dismissed bachelor loves, being last long,
thy pole-clipped vineyard, and thy sea-marge, sterile and rocky hard, where thou thyself dost err, the queen of the sky, whose watery arch and messenger am I, bids thee leave these, and with her sovereign grace, here on this grass plot in this very place, to come and sport, her peacocks fly amain. Approach, rich Ceres, here to entertain.
Hail, many-colored messenger that ne'er dost disobey the wife of Jupiter, who, with thy saffron wings upon my flowers, diffusest honey drops, refreshing showers, and with each end of thy blue bough dost crown my bosky acres and my unshrubbed down, rich scarf to my proud earth. Why hath thy queen summoned me hither to this short grass green?
A contract of true love to celebrate, and some donation freely to estate on the blessed lovers.
Most majestic vision, and harmonious, charmingly. May I be bold to think these spirits?
Spirits which by mine art I have from their confines called to enact my present fancies.
Let me live here ever! So rare a wondered parent and a wise makes this place paradise.
Increasing poise and plenty, barns and garners never empty, vines with clustering bunches growing, plants with goodly bird and mowing, spring come to you.
Forgot that foul conspiracy of Beast Caliban and his confederates against my life. The minute of their plot is almost come. Well done. Avoid! No more!
This is strange. Prospero's in some passion that works them strongly.
Never till this day saw I my parent touched with anger, so distempered.
You do look, my son, in a moved sort, as if you were dismayed. Be cheerful, sir. Our revels now are ended. These, our actors, as I foretold you, were all spirits, and are melted into air. Into thin air. And like the baseless fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, yea, all which it inherit, shall dissolve. And, like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep. Sir, I am vexed. Bear with my weakness. My old brain is troubled. Be not disturbed with my infirmity. If you be pleased, retire into my cell and there repose. A turn or two I'll walk to still my beating mind.
We wish your peace.
Ariel, come with a thought. I thank thee. Come.
Thy thoughts I cleave to. What's thy pleasure?
Spirit, we must prepare to meet with Caliban. Say again, where didst thou leave these varlets?
I told you, sir. They were red hot with drinking, so full of valor that they smote the air for breathing in their faces. Then I beat my tabor, at which, like unbacked colts, they pricked their ears, advanced their eyelids, lifted up their noses as they smelt music. So I charmed their ears, that calf-like they my lowing followed. At last I led them here, dancing up to the chins.
This was well done, my bird. Thy shape invisible, retain thou still. A devil, a born devil, on whose nature nurture can never stick, on whom my pains, humanely taken, all lost, quite lost. I will plague them all, even to roaring.
Pray you, Lord Stefano, tread softly, that the blind mole may not hear a footfall. We are now near their cell.
Monster, your fairy, which you say is a harmless fairy, has done little better than played the jack with us.
Good, my lord, give me thy favor still. Be patient, for the prize I'll bring thee shall hoodwink this mischance. Therefore speak softly. All's hushed as midnight yet.
But to lose our bottles in the pool?
There is not only disgrace and dishonor in that monster, but an infinite loss.
Prithee, my king, be quiet. Seest thou here? This is the mouth of Prosper's cell. No noise! Do that good mischief, which may make this island thine own forever. And I... thy Caliban, for I thy foot licker.
Give me thy hand. I do begin to have bloody thoughts.
Hi, Ariel. Call the spirits from the vasty deep.
What noise is that?
These be the spirits of old Prospero, whose hounds are bred of the spectral kind. So flued, so sanded, their heads are hung with ears that sweep away the warning dew.
Savage Clem, this is the chase. I am gone forever.
They roar!
Let them be hunted soundly. This hour lies at my mercy all mine enemies. Shortly shall all my labors end, and thou shalt have the air at freedom. For a little, follow and do me service. My project gather to a head. Say, my spirit, how fares the king and his followers?
The king Alonso, his sister Sebastian, and your sister Antonia abide all three distracted, and the counselor mourning over them, brim full of sorrow and dismay.
Him that you termed, sir, the good old Lord Gonzalo,
his tears run down his beard, like winter's drops from eaves of reeds. Your charm so strongly works them that if you now beheld them, your affections would become tender.
Dost thou think so, spirit?
Mine would, were I human.
And mine shall. Hast thou, which art but air, a touch, a feeling of their afflictions? And shall not myself, one of their kind, that relish all as sharply passion as they, be kindlier moved than thou art? Though with their high wrongs I am struck to the quick, yet with my nobler reason against my fury do I take part. The rarer action is in virtue than in vengeance. They being penitent, the sole drift of my purpose doth extend not a frown further. Go.
Release them, Ariel. My charms I'll break, their senses I'll restore, and they shall be themselves.
I'll fetch them, sir.
You elves of hills, brooks, standing lakes, and groves, and you that on the sands with printless foot do chase the ebbing Neptune, and do fly him when he comes back. You demi-puppets that by moonshine did the green sour ringlets make whereof the ewe not bites. And you whose pastime is to make midnight mushrooms, that rejoice to hear the solemn curfew, by whose aid, weak masters though you be, I have bedimmed the noontide sun, called forth the mutinous winds, and twixt the green sea and the azured vault set roaring war. To the dread rattling thunder have I given fire, and rifted Jove's stout oak with his own bolt. The strong-based promontory have I made shake, and by the spurs plucked up the pine and cedar. Graves at my command have waked their sleepers, oaked and led them forth by my so potent art. But this rough magic I here abjure. And when I have acquired some heavenly music, which even now I do, to work mine end upon their senses that this airy charm is for, I'll break my staff, bury it certain fathoms in the earth, and deeper than did ever plummet sound, I'll drown my book. A solemn air, and the best comforter to an unsettled fancy, cure thy brains, now useless, boiled within thy skull. There stand, for you are spell-stopped. Holy Gonzalo, honorable man, mine eyes, even sociable to the show of thine, fall fellowly drops. Good Gonzalo, my true preserver and a loyal sir to him thou followest, I will pay thy graces home, both in word and deed. Most cruelly didst thou, Alonso, use me and my daughter. Thy sister was a furtherer in the act. Thou art pinched for it now, Sebastian. Flesh and blood, you, sister mine, that entertained ambition, expelled remorse and nature, whom, with Sebastian, would here have killed your king. I do forgive thee, unnatural though thou art. Their understanding begins to swell, and the approaching tide will shortly fill the reasonable shore that now lies foul and muddy. Ariel, come. So, to the king's ship, invisible as thou art. There shalt thou find the mariners asleep under the hatches, the master and the boatswain being awake, enforce them to this place, and presently, I prithee.
I drink the air before me, and return before your pulse twice beat.
All torment, trouble, wonder, and amazement inhabits here. Some heavenly power guide us out of this fearful country.
Behold, Sir King, the wronged Duke of Milan, Prospero, and to thee and thy company, I bid a hearty welcome.
Whether thou beest Prospero or no, or some enchanted trifle to abuse me, as late I have been, I not know. Thy pulse beats as of flesh and blood, and since I saw thee, the affliction of my mind amends. This must crave, and if this be at all, a most strange story. Thy dukedom I resign, and do entreat thou pardon me my wrongs, but how should Prospero be living and be here?
First, Gonzalo, let me embrace you, sir, whose honor cannot be measured or confined.
Whether this be, or be not. I'll not swear.
You do yet taste some subtleties of the isle that will not let you believe things certain. Welcome, my friends all. But you, Antonia and Sebastian, were I so minded, I could here pluck his highness frown upon you and justify you traitors. At this time I will tell no tales.
The devil speaks in you.
For you, wicked Antonia, whom to call sister would even infect my mouth, I do forgive thy rankest fault, all of them, and require my dukedom of thee, which perforce I know thou must restore.
If thou be'st Prospero, give us particulars of thy preservation. How thou hast met us here, who are racked upon this shore, where I have lost. How sharp the point of this remembrance is. My dear son Ferdinand.
I am woe for it, sir, for I have lost my daughter.
A daughter? Oh, heaven, that they were living both in Naples, the king and queen there. That they were. I wish myself were mudded in that oozy bed where my son lies. When did you lose your daughter?
In this last tempest. This cell's my court. Pray you look in. My dukedom, since you have given me again, I will requite you with as good a thing. At least bring forth a wonder to content you as much as me, my dukedom.
My sweet Lord Ferdinand, I hope you are not false.
No, my dearest love, I am not for the world.
If this prove a vision of the island, one dear son shall I twice lose.
A most high miracle, 'tis Ferdinand.
Though the seas threaten, they are merciful. I have cursed them without cause.
Now, all the blessings of a glad father compass thee about. Arise, and say how thou camest here.
Wonder, how many goodly creatures are there here? How beauteous mankind is! Oh, brave new world that has such people in it!
What is this maid that is now at your side? Is she the goddess that has severed us and brought us thus together?
Sir, she is mortal, but by immortal providence, she's mine. I chose her when I could not ask my father for his advice, nor thought I had one. She's daughter to this famous Duke of Milan, of whom I have received a second life, and second parent this lady makes them to me.
Was Milan thrust from Milan that the issue should become King of Naples? Oh, rejoice beyond a common joy! In one voyage did Ferdinand find a wife where he himself was lost. Prospero, their dukedom in a poor isle. And all of us ourselves, when no man was his own. Oh, look, sir, look, sir. Here is more of us. What is the news, boatswain?
The best news is that we have safely found our king and company. The next, our ship is tight and yar and bravely rigged as when we first put out at sea.
These are not natural events. They strengthen from strange to stranger. Say, how came you hither?
If I did think, sir, I were well awake, I'd strive to tell you. We were dead of sleep, and how, we know not, all clapped under hatches, where but even now, with strange and several noises of roaring, shrieking, howling, jingling chains, and more diversity of sounds, all horrible, we were awaked, straightway at liberty, where we, in all her trim, freshly beheld our royal, good, and gallant ship.
Sir, all this service have I done since I went.
My tricksy spirit.
Was it well done?
Bravely, my diligence. Thou shalt be free.
This is as strange a maze as e'er men trod. And there is in this business more than nature was ever conduct of. Some oracle must rectify our knowledge.
Sir, my liege, do not infest your mind with beating on the strangeness of this business. Be cheerful and think of each thing well. Come hither, spirit. Set Caliban and his companions free. Untie the spell. How fares my gracious king? There are yet missing of your company some few odd lads that you remember not.
It is our men. Stefano, Triculo.
For all is but fortune. Coraggio, bully monster.
Coraggio. Mm.
If these be true spies which I wear in my head, here's a goodly sight.
Oh, these be brave spirits indeed.
What things are these, my lord Antonia? Will money buy them?
Very like. One of them is a plain fish and no doubt marketable.
These three have plotted to take my life. Two of these fellows you must know and own. This thing of malice, I acknowledge mine.
I shall be pinched to death.
Is not this Stefano, my drunken butler?
He is drunk now. Where had he wine?
And Trinculo is reeling ripe. Where should they find this grand liquor that hath gilded them? How camest thou in this pickle, Trinculo?
I've been in such a pickle since I saw you last.
Why, how now, Stefano?
Oh, touch me not! I am not Stefano, but a crank.
This is as strange a fish as e'er I looked on.
Go, Caliban, to my cell. Take with you your companions, as you look to have my pardon, trim it handsomely.
What a thrice double ass was I to take this drunkard for a god and worship this dull fool?
Hey.
Go to. Away.
Farewell, master. Farewell, farewell.
Alonso, I invite your highness and your train to my poor cell, where you shall take your rest for this one night, which part of it all waste with such discourse as the story of my life, and the particular accidents gone by since I came to this isle. And in the morn, I'll bring you to your ship, and so to Naples, where I have hope to see the nuptial of these our dear beloved solemnized, and thence retire me to my Milan, where every third thought shall be my grave.
I long to hear the story of your life, which must take the ear strangely.
I'll deliver all, and promise you calm seas, auspicious gales, and sail so expeditious that shall catch your royal fleet far off. My Ariel, chick, that is thy charge. Then to the elements be free. And fare thou well. Please you, draw near. Now my charms are all o'erthrown, and what strength I have is mine own, which is most faint. Now 'tis true I must be here confined by you, or sent to Naples. Let me not, since I have my dukedom got and pardoned the deceiver, dwell in this bare island by your spell. But release me from my bands, with the help of your good hands. Gentle breath of yours my sails must fill, or else my project fails, which was to please. Now I want spirits to enforce, art to enchant, and my ending is despair. Unless I be relieved by prayer, which pierces so that it assaults mercy itself and frees all faults. As you from crimes would pardoned be, let your indulgence set me free.
Ariella Aldase as the Bosun.
Murtaza Hassan as Gonzalo.
Jackie Becerra as Sebastian.
Ryan Tan as Stefano.
Jasper McAvity as Alonso and Trinculo.
Lexi Linker as Miranda.
Sohan Bichare as Caliban and Ferdinand.
Audrey Sr. as Ariel and Antonia.
And Addie Garner as Prospero. The Tempest is adapted by Cecilia Ergetta, and graphic design is by Izzy Ruiz. Our music is composed by Wilder Seitz and Audrey Sr., and our sound design is by Wilder Seitz, Abligalib, and Julia Jorgensen. The Tempest is produced by Arielle DeVito and directed by Ryan Tan for the Stanford Shakespeare Company.
Thank you so much for coming to our show. If you're interested, please stick around for two talkbacks with the director and members of our production team. The first talkback is about race and colonialism in The Tempest, and the second focuses on the sound design and composing process for the show. Once again, thank you all, and have a great rest of the night.
Okay, getting started for real. Okay. My name is Ryan Tan. I use he, him pronouns. I am the director, and I also play Stefano. And today I am joined by two lovely guests who also worked on the show.
Hi, everyone. My name is Ariella Algase, and I use she, her pronouns. I played the bosun in The Tempest and am also the director of the Shake Race project for the Stanford Shakespeare Company.
Hey everyone, I'm Sohan. My pronouns are he, him. I play Caliban and Ferdinand, two very similar roles in The Tempest.
Awesome. Yeah, and so what this chat is kind of our way of attempting to address what it means to do The Tempest in a post-colonial quote-unquote context. And what do you think might be most important when we consider these racial and colonial dynamics in The Tempest?
Sure. I decided to pitch a project of a reading group that meets every couple of weeks in the quarter to talk about issues of race and racisms in Shakespeare, both in an early modern context and in a contemporary context. I wanted this project to be a way for us to consider as a company to reflect on how race affects our interpretations of Shakespeare, with the ultimate goal of being a more intentional and accessible praxis as theater makers and artists. Because of the kind of unique situation we have this year, we were able to integrate our Shake Race reading group within The Tempest. So we met as the entire cast and crew met early on in the quarter or early on in the process to discuss two readings, one theoretical, Kim Hall's Things of Darkness, particularly about the place of The Tempest in the early modern imagination and the themes of miscegenation, racial violence, and colonial fantasies within the text. And the second piece was Aimé Césaire's play, Une Tempête, a post-colonial adaptation of The Tempest that explores the dynamics of race, power, and colonialism within Shakespeare and the political context of the 1960s as a way of reclaiming this 400-year-old text. That, I think, is a very powerful beginning for us to consider the theme of race in The Tempest, not only to consider it within its early modern context, but to explore how it can be used, how the text can be used as a way of renegotiating fault lines among the fault lines along race within our contemporary world. And this production is very much inspired by our efforts in trying to renegotiate those very fault lines.
Great. And yeah, I just want to pose the same question to Sohan.
Yeah, great question. Also, first of all, Arielle, that was very eloquent. I will probably be less eloquent.
Thank you.
But yeah, here's my little take, which is that like The Tempest, you said it's 400 years old. It's probably been done like thousands to tens of thousands of times by now, like an absurd amount of times. And I mean, that's why like I love doing Shakespeare's, because it's been done so much. It's absurdly freeing as an actor. I feel like just because the play has been done how it was quote unquote meant to be done by Shakespeare already, and how other directors meant it to be done so many times, now we're sitting here and we can do it however we want to. We're like absolutely free to wield this text however we want. And we can't, or maybe it's not the best decision or not our goal to stray completely away from it, right? Like we were mm-hmm. doing The Tempest, but we can wield the words in the way we want to and point them the way we want to, kind of without any obligation to what's in front of us. I think, yeah, wielding words and wielding exactly what those words mean in this context just lets you take a relationship that's complicated and may say things you don't want it to say in the way you think it was intended to be written, and turn that into just your own work. And I think that's what we did. I mean, we just thought through every scene, treated Caliban as, you know, like I was empathizing with Caliban the whole time. We never ever made fun of Caliban. And I think that just by nature of doing that, put a lot of things out there in the right way.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And just to add on to that, Sohan, I loved your choice of words in what you said, wielding words, because we see in The Tempest how words can, in a sense, become a weapon. And I know that in the beginning of this process, the production crew and I sat down to talk about whether or not we should delete some of the racist right. language in the script, because we didn't want these words that are repeated to become, you know, these become like weapons that we wield. Yes. We didn't want to repeat their rhetorical violence. So I think that's just a very beautiful way of putting what Shakespeare's language does and can do.
Thanks. Yeah. And yeah, you're right. It's meta because like Caliban wields words in the play. Like that's, you know, his power too, and him taking it back. So yeah. Okay, cool.
Yeah. My philosophy, I guess, in trying to adapt this play is how do we, if it's possible at all, how do we do this in today's context without making this into something that erases the ugliness of the original text? How do we adapt it to subvert these themes? The difficulty for me lies in how do we take this text that is clearly dated and has this racist language in it, and like Sohan, you were saying, like what freedoms can we have with the language that is in the text? So some of that was straight up cutting some stuff out, but others are, how can we subvert this and say, yes, this is the language Shakespeare is given, and yet this is what it can also mean? Yeah. So while we're talking about Shakespeare, I wonder if we can sort of dive into more of the colonial context, the historical context of where he was writing.
So Kim Hall and Things of Darkness particularly argues that race, and particularly the delineation of black versus white, is something through which English authors and writers are able to kind of negotiate the very identity of Englishness. And we see this even though in The Tempest, even though it is not necessarily, it is not set in England, we still see these traces of the colonial links between England and Africa on one hand, specifically Tunisia, and specifically also we see references to Native Americans and to Black Africans as well. So Caliban is this heavily racialized character, and different scholars have theorized that The Tempest can be best understood within, for example, the context of the early colonial Americas, also in the middle of the Mediterranean. But nevertheless, what these scholars agree on is kind of the racialization of the language and of these characters that sets this this play within a uniquely early modern context that is in some ways very different, but in some ways very similar to the ones we find ourselves in 2020.
Yeah. So obviously the most racialized character in this play is Caliban, who is referred to throughout the text as a slave. We know that when Prospero and Miranda first landed on the island, he was the king of it. And he sort of, they got along just fine. And in fact, taught Caliban language, etc., until Caliban tries to rape Miranda. And this is a troubling instance, naturally, of how do we deal with this incident in The Tempest? And ultimately we decided that this piece of information is going to be kept in the play because it's part of the ugliness, I guess, of how Shakespeare characterizes Caliban. And I don't know if you guys have other opinions, but I think ultimately we came to a decision that there would be some sort of patronizing nature to try to erase what Shakespeare as a white English man writ into this text. And instead of trying to erase that he had said that ugly thing at all, we tried to subvert it in an informed sort of way.
Exactly. Like on one side, erasing them, it may be totally patronizing. And on the other side, playing into them and making parts of them like all he is, does something like that's maybe harmful to put out into the world. And the right answer is walking this line in the middle and like kind of fighting like the weird beauty in the middle where you make people ask the right questions, but you take those themes and you turn them into a character which is provocative in a productive way and in an engaging way. Because, you know, the play is, I mean, so much, such a fun play too. So in a captivating way. And yeah, I mean, I think that's what we tried to do. And I think the best way to turn a lot of the conversations we had and what I did, so I don't know if it's the best way, it's what I did, it's what I thought was the right way to do it, turn a lot of the conversations we had into a performance which reflects these things, is keep them in mind and then portray Caliban fully, honestly.
Definitely.
A lot of the things Caliban says about Miranda like are snide and are turned into like him using words to poke at Prospero in a really gross way. And yeah, I mean, I think one thing that I used to walk that line was Caliban's like a little intellectual, he's clever, you know? and he at one point like empathizes with Stefano and like makes him feel okay. Like he's definitely caring, he's clever, definitely, but he's also like really grossly prodding. Like, one of the, like, there's, like, those seven things that humans do that you can kind of play into as an actor. And one of them is poking and or prodding. I forget the exact ones. But Caliban's definitely a huge poker. A lot of what he says is so targeted. He's, like, poking people, like, right in the neck. And he kind of leans into that as a way to fight back. I mean, I think, like, part of Caliban's frustration, I mean, you see it. He can say all these big words, and then he uses them to, like, use metaphors to describe how much he's hurt and how unreasonable his situation is, and the evil things the spirits Prospero does, as Prospero sets on him due to him. I mean, it's like the immense frustration of, I can do all of this, but now I'm just using it to describe how I'm being hurt. It's like immense tragic frustration. And that is mirrored a lot in the lines Caliban says, but also in the plot where he's stuck with Stefano and Trinculo as his means to like save himself. And yeah, like no wonder he gets drunk and kind of goes a little loopy and just throws things at the wall. I mean, it's just like, on one hand, it's like funny, it's the comic plot, but on the other hand, it's just like another example of this tragic, you know, like this is the best, this is Caliban's best shot. Like it's seriously this that fits with the frustration he has in a lot of moments in his lines.
Yeah. And going off of what you were saying, I think that part of, because I think that the Stefano Trinculo Caliban plot, that's the hardest thing in the Tempest to do right. Because if we look at the text, it seems very clear. This is basically just straight comedy for Shakespeare. There are of course moments when Caliban gets to show, yes, indeed, he is of higher status than these two buffoons. Though there's no greater density of jokes in this play than in that plot. And so my work, I guess, as a director and in thinking of how do we do this text is, and give respect to Caliban, but without being patronizing, is we kind of made it a dark comedy plot, as opposed to just a straight comedy plot. We kind of introduced those tragic elements you were talking about, Sohan, of, yes, all of this stuff, and this kind of plays into our sound design as well, in that at first, this island seems to be this idyllic sort of paradise, magical place. But as if we look closer at Stefano, Trinculo, and Caliban and what is happening, it's really freaking ugly. And this kind of echoes what you had said earlier, that we always wanted Caliban never to be the butt of the joke. We always wanted the butt of the joke to be who Stefano and Trinculo are, as failing to be these wannabe exerting their authority over this person who is clearly stronger and smarter, wiser than them.
Yeah. I think one thing that was important to the point you were making about making that like a dark comedy and using the jokes to point out what was going on was the during that scene, like Caliban is fully committed, 100% committed to believing Stefano is his master. Yeah, I think that was something I really wanted to poke at with Caliban. Is like, and you caught me a lot when I remember when we were doing that scene too, because a lot of those lines are so ridiculous, they're just hard to deliver.
Yeah. he's saying these things like, I will be your foot licker forever, things like that. Yeah. And it's well, yeah, Shakespeare is probably writing this thing that's very funny, but it's, I don't know. I think that we, in our modern context, we hear that and it's like, it's like, ridiculous. Oh. It's absurd. It's absurd funny, but it's also absurd, like sad, like.
Yeah. Yeah. And something like cool happens if you don't make fun of that line.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. No.
If you deliver that line, honestly, it, I think is hard to wrangle with and hits exactly what we were talking about.
Yeah. Well, let's quickly talk about my weird casting choice of, since the start, I wanted to double Caliban and Ferdinand, because obviously they both have this relationship with Miranda and with Prospero. And I sort of wanted to not necessarily give answers, but to highlight this, by this intentional casting choice, highlight this sort of foiling between these two characters and how our Ferdinand is, or in the text, Ferdinand's apparently a noble prince who comes, woos Miranda over, you know, with Prospero's manipulation. And Caliban apparently starts the story off as this stock monster character. And what I love about Sohan's performance is your choices that you made for Ferdinand versus your choices that you made for Caliban. And so I just want to hear more about the contrast between these two characters and your decisions and how you characterize them and what that sort of means for this, for these difficult topics that we've been trying to discuss.
I was far more okay with making fun of Ferdinand as an actor than I was with making fun of Caliban. Caliban, I felt like needed to be played straight, needed to play honestly, needed to be played empathetically, keeping a lot of things in mind to direct where Caliban was shooting. But I think wherever Caliban shoots, he almost does it, you know, fully transparently. Mm-hmm. And this was a lot of the conversations that Ryan and I had. You know, Ryan would kind of ask, like, what is your motivation? What are you trying to get out of the scene? What are you feeling things out? And for Caliban, a lot of the times it was the obvious one. it was maybe like one or two orders deep. And I mean, I think part of that is this is an audio play and simple intentions and playing them well is kind of what I try to do as an actor. And I feel like works a lot better than playing weird, complicated intentions. But it also seemed, I think, the right way to play Caliban, given the conversations we were having. Ferdinand, on the other hand, I was far more okay with, as an actor, making fun of him in my portrayal. Just because, you know, Ferdinand walks in like he's the king of this place. You know, like he is kind of in aloofness, like nothing can possibly go wrong. And even when Ferdinand's getting trapped by magic, he's kind of like, oh, magic, you know? it's not a big deal. And Ferdinand's I'm always gonna be fineness is I think something that was a really, really fun to capitalize on and to poke fun at and to use in interesting ways. So that's the first thing I would say is the level of, so I wouldn't say like honesty because both were played honestly, but yeah. The level of empathy in both performances was different. And the goal for both performances was very different.
I think the fact that we were working in a radio play format gave us this really unique opportunity to think about the theory in the social sciences and literary studies of the sonic color line. Mm-hmm. This is something that that the Folgers Critical Race Conversations had an event workshop about this year. Asserting something which I truly believe that race is not is not merely an epidermal description. It is a sensorial phenomenon that has deep implications for sound studies and the ways in which we work with and interpret the things that we hear. We can't really see Caliban's race
right.
And Ferdinand's race, but they're still racialized. But Caliban is still racialized through the text, and by not being able to see that visual, that epidermal descriptor, I'm really able to interrogate. I think the very foundations of what we think of and perceive of as race.
I'd like to thank both of you for your time. Thanks for coming. This has been a lot of fun. And
thanks, yes. Ryan.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right.
All right. Welcome to our second talk back. This one is about sound. My name is Ryan. I am the director of the show. I use he, him pronouns.
Hi, I'm Wilder. I use he, him, and I was the co-composer on the show, as well as kind of the lead sound engineer and designer.
Hi, I'm Julia. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm one of the sound designers on this show.
Hi, my name is Audrey. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm an actor in the show. I play Ariel and Antonia. I also co-composed the music for the show with Wilder, and I'm the artistic director of the Stanford Shakespeare Company.
Great. And the focus of this chat is just to kind of get into sound design, which for this show, and especially as a radio play format, is particularly unique in both the process and the philosophy, I guess, that we brought to the show.
Yeah, I guess just like a couple places, the power of magic and music and sound and sort of the art of theater itself and the material of life all kind of collapse into this kind of entity that's, you know, representative of the power of theater in some ways. And so with Shakespeare, sort of that's always one of the wellsprings, you know, that you're coming from. Another, like Midsummer, right, is very, like, you know, it takes place in a forest as well, but the power is, I guess, reads to me as somehow more arcane in a way, more kind of a separate world, whereas, oh, and I guess this kind of plays into your whole Buddhist thing, but like whereas the magic and the tempest definitely feels a lot more rooted, I would say, in the forces of, you know, nature itself, right? Prospero, I guess, you know, sort of the very obvious example of that, right, is Prospero, who was this you know, literal wizard in their ivory tower, you know, in the old world, quote unquote, and then they are, you know, sent off into this new realm in which they have, you know, literally nothing except the forces of the elements around them themselves, and they become a very powerful magician and kind of controller of reality, but through that. So both Ryan and myself had been rewatching Avatar: The Last Airbender at the time, so that sort of played into it as one of the inspirations as well. We're the kind of four people who live on the island, Prospero, Ariel, Caliban, and Miranda sort of are almost representative of the four elements in a kind of, you know, Aristotelian way. Caliban is water, or Prospero is water, Caliban is the earth, Ariel as air, and Miranda as a kind of fire in a way, you know, sort of the spirit of like joie de vivre. And then I guess I'm already going on very long, but I'd say a final kind of place of inspiration was music. You know, I'm very, very into music. It's one of my favorite things. And a lot of what I'd been listening to this year was in this very kind of folky, I guess like freak folk kind of psychedelic vein that, you know, focuses very heavily on, you know, kind of found sounds and field recordings and, you know, interesting weird guitar tunings and stuff like that, and a lot of that ended up filtering and especially into the more musical related elements of the show.
Awesome. Yeah, so picking up some of those things, when Arielle first approached with the idea for a radio play and me as a director, my first thought on what play might fit would be, well, obviously all of Shakespeare's plays have language as an important theme. But unlike some of those other plays, The Tempest is also very concerned with music. And tying that into magic, not only in the action of the events of the play, but also in theme and how music and magic and kind of the island and all of that are in a lot of ways tied in with each other, and how magic grants a lot of things, power being maybe the most obvious of them, but as we see in the play, a lot of other interesting things.
Well, I would say that there is like an innate connection in this play between like humans and the natural world, and especially between Prospero and the natural world, because Prospero actually causes the tempest and causes a lot of the like natural world goings on in this play. So it's been really interesting to actually like listen to or think about what like a tempest would sound like, or what thunder or what wind would sound like, and then try to think about how we can incorporate like a human nature into that, in the sense that like if Prospero yells, can it sound like thunder? Like
if there's wind, can it sound like breathing?
It's like in the sound design, we can actually create a kind of connection between the human world and the spirit world, which is already so prominent in the play.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. The place where we see the biggest intersection between this theater making natural world and music is in the play that Prospero puts on for Miranda and Ferdinand, in which Prospero and Ariel play these roles of these Greek gods and sing a marriage song together. And that was definitely something that Wilder and Ryan and Julia and I all talked about when we were composing that specific scene, was how to make the actual theater in the broader play sound distinct from everything else going on and sound especially magical, because Prospero's magic comes through their use of language, and we see that through their book that they use to cast spells, that the words that Prospero uses to make magic are integral to the plot of the show and the themes and the actions. And so in a scene in which Prospero literally writes a sung play that they have their servant fairy perform, it was integral to us to have that sound be heightened and connect a sort of archaic, old world, almost Christian liturgical sound with something that sounded magical and strange. We were able to make that through having a rather classic melody and then integrating all kinds of strange timing and instruments into the scenes to make it stand out and sound really distorted.
There is kind of an interesting friction with right, like you were talking about, you know, Prospero and this kind of power of theater and power of creation that they have. That is what's, you know, sort of propelling a lot of the sound design of most of the show, right? Is, you know, these sort of very kind of conscious creations, conscious compositions in a sense, you know, from Prospero. But at the same time, the island is itself, you know, it itself does hold this other kind of magic, which, you know, Caliban speaks and Ariel both speak to, especially, right? You know, these kind of magical creatures were already washed up there before Prospero even got there. Ariel and Caliban are already natural foils just in the text, right? But to sonically foil them as well, right? In which Ariel is very kind of breathy, right? All the most of the wind in the show, in fact, is even, you know, my literal me going like into the mic. You can tell which, you can actually, if you're listening to it, you can tell which of the scenes were put together earlier or later based on the quality of the mouth wind noises. Like if it sounds like a dude just going like in your ear, then it's probably one of the earlier ones. But if the, so like I got a lot better at making mouth wind over the course of the process. But you know, that kind of imbues, you know, this natural airy spirit of Ariel with, you know, this kind of literal living vivacious presence, whereas Caliban is very rooted and almost gravelly, and his footsteps have, you know, resonate a little on the earth itself, and his instrument isn't, you know, this kind of strummy guitar, but it's instead, you know, this kind of single low drum that beats with, you know, something very close to the earth in that way.
So kind of moving a little bit away from sound effects in themselves, but also into more of the music and the composing parts of the process. What was your number one philosophies while you were composing music for the show?
So Wilder and I actually had the opportunity to live together in the fall, and that was a great creative space for us to work together and create music. I remember when I first started writing music, I was writing things that sounded much more choral, much more like traditionally Western. And after having a conversation about what that sounded like, Wilder and I thought we would just brainstorm and play around with sound. And it was one of my most fun theater making experiences of my life, was the first night that Wilder and I worked together and wrote Coming to These Yellow Sands. He just started playing the guitar and I just started singing. And the version that you hear in the radio play is basically that first recording, like that, come unto these yellow sands. Like we wrote that very day. It was the first thing that came to mind. And something about that speaks to the naturalism of the music in the show, that everything that Ariel sings is natural. It is her instinct. It fits with who she is. And so to have the opportunity to play that character and create that music in such a natural and fun environment really aided to the sound of the show.
For sure. It was really just a lot of, like Audrey was saying, I'd never really like made music. I mean, I've, you know, like arranged a little music before, and, you know, I know little bits and pieces of music theory from like doing piano in high school and stuff like that. But I'd never really, you know, sort of experienced what that's like before. And that was really, really cool. And it, yeah, the whole process was really just, you know it when you hear it, and then you just find that seed and you grab hold of it. And then you kind of, you know, it all kind of forces its way out of that. Yeah, I don't know. That was basically writing, you know, the demo versions, the sort of structures, and then to sort of, you know, fully flesh out the songs. It was really just stealing parts of other people's music that I really like and figuring out how to combine them. So I've taken, you know, a fair amount of creative writing classes, and basically all of them, you know, the teacher will say at least once, you're only going to ever write as well as what you read. Like, reading is one of the most important parts of writing well, just like reading good things. And I'd say the exact same thing about sound design, especially because it's like such a literally referential art, you know, like a lot of the times it's literally taking the things that you've heard themselves, you know, sounds that you've experienced in your life, and then, you know, sort of combining them and melding them. You know, like a big influence. I'll, you know, literally proselytize to anyone who comes within 10 feet of me about Animal Collective, but they're like my favorite band ever. I cried when I saw them live. They're just, you know, the coolest. So right before this conversation started, Ryan was talking to us about kind of, you know, this Nietzschean idea of you know, kind of living life as a piece of art, or trying to create art out of, you know, the material of life. And, you know, Nietzsche, this was one of his big ideas that he had, as, you know, kind of how to escape modernity and return to monkey, so to speak. But you know, Ryan was talking about how maybe, you know, sort of throughout the process of the show, maybe that idea got changed a little, in the same way that, you know, sort of Prospero's arc across the show is very much about maybe coming to recognize that this, you know, grand theater that they've been creating out of all their little pawns is maybe not the best way to go about, you know, being a human and stuff like that. And so what I really enjoy about Animal Collective is that their music to me kind of taps into this way in which art can move beyond that, you know, kind of conscious Nietzschean constructed idea, and really tap into, you know, just this kind of deep, you know, subdermal, subconscious level of like the flow of things, I guess, is the only, you know, there aren't any good words for it. And I don't think that there ever will be good words for it, as with most of the great feelings in life, you know, but it kind of taps into that way in which art cannot just be about, you know, sort of constructing a story on top of reality, but about accessing something beyond that entirely, you know, something that's very somatic and embodied. And that was, those were the kinds of sounds I think that I was trying to draw out of that kind of folky or psychedelic musical influences. So very textural sounds, very sounds that are, you know, familiar maybe, you know, so all the, you know, folk songs, right? They're famous for, you know, three chords and a man who's sad about the government or whatever, you know, so like three chords, but you tune up your guitar interestingly, or this, it's very disorienting and the sounds pass between, you know, your stereo field, and it kind of captures that familiarity and that essence of things while also making it feel fresh and alive and like a new take on seeing, you know, seeing the flower anew, seeing the tree for the first time, that kind of thing.
Yeah, like Shakespeare itself is just so musical, like always. Shakespeare writes, yeah, in iambic pentameter, which of course is, you know, the sound of the heart beating. I think Shakespeare really understood how like music is so natural to humans as a form of expression. So it was fun to really emphasize this in the show. And one of the things I pay attention to in the sound design, when sort of figuring out how to meld the singing and the speaking together, is just trying to make sure that they flow together very naturally. Because especially in this show, like they're not actually that separate, because singing and music is being used as like just as much a form of expression, as Audrey was saying, like of the characters themselves as speaking is.
Yeah. And going off of what Julia was saying, there are times in the show where it almost feels like musical theater, in that you know, one of the classic rules is the blending of the speech with the music, and there are parts in the show that we really do it just speaks about how the way that Prospero kind of crafts these situations, they're all larger than life, perhaps none more extra than the harpy scene, for instance, where the sound design is just absolutely wild. Things are happening all over the place. And Arielle, maybe that's her strongest moment of showing like just how much command she has over sound itself, sound as a pure material entity in itself, and just all the things that Arielle can do with sound with the island backing her.
That's some of my favorite sound design that happened in the show. The concept was sort of, I was just, you know, kind of working off this idea of like the exploding guitar, like because that's sort of Arielle's instrument, which he's paired with throughout the show. The sounds in that scene are almost like, this, the concept here is you're the pick that fell into the guitar and now God's trying to shake you out of it. But it ends up having so much resonant potential in a different way, because those sounds, like the taps on the body of it, for example, become almost like these hummingbird wings, right, that kind of flit in and around your ears and disorient you in that way. And the sounds themselves kind of circle around in a way that, you know, kind of traps your headspace in this nightmare trip. I don't know. I think one of the things that I've come to as far as my own sound design philosophy over the course of the show is that shows treat design still as an afterthought, and sound design is sort of the most afterthought of all the afterthoughts. But theater is ultimately about, you know, the words that people are saying, right? You know, it is, you know, I'd say maybe film is a much more, you know, multimedia balanced medium, whereas theater is really all about focusing in on the words themselves, and the words are living in the same universe as your sounds are. And I think that this show maybe kind of approaches being a thesis on that, on letting the whole thing kind of live and breathe and move in conjunction as its own kind of art object, in a way that I think is infinitely harder to achieve in a live setting, right? Because your timing is so variable every time, and you really need to, you know, figure out how to screw around with all your like live presets and, you know, QLab chains and groups and stuff to try and approximate that. But you can really kind of hone in on that sense of artistic resonance in a show like this.
Cool. Thank you to my guests, Wilder, Audrey, and Julia, for your time and your lovely insights into sound design of the show. And thank you all again for listening. We hope you enjoyed our talk, and we'll see you in the next Shake Show, I guess.
Yeah, thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the show.